meeting to order at 7:35. My name is Carl Midnight. I'm the chair of the Historic Commission. I'm going to have to amend the agenda with one item. Currently, we only have three members, full members, here at the hearing because two couldn't make it. And we need actually five members to conduct the hearing. And one of the new changes to the bylaws in Reading allows me to appoint two of our associate members to act as full members for the purposes of this hearing and if any continuances, if there are any. So I'd like to appoint Jack Williams and Virginia Adams as full members for purposes of the hearing.
Welcome.
If Charlene could begin the meeting with reading the public notice.
All right. This is to serve as notice that the Reading Historical Commission, under the authority and requirements of Section 7.2, Historic Demolition Delay, of the General Bylaws of the Town of Reading, Massachusetts, shall hold a public hearing on the application to demolish the structure included on the list of historic structures as defined in Section 7.2.3, located at 258 Main Street, Reading, Mass. 01867, submitted by applicant Chris Latham. The public hearing will be held on Thursday, December 10th, 2015, at 7:30 p.m. in the first floor conference room at the Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street. Please direct public inquiry to Jean Delios in the Public Service Office.
Thanks, Charlene. And by way of a more formal introduction to why we're all here and what the Historic Commission does, I'd like to read the following. In 1977, Town Meeting established the Reading Historical Commission and charged the RHC with a mission to identify and record historic assets of the town and to develop and implement a program for their preservation. One of the means we have to follow this purpose is the Demolition Delay Bylaw. We are here this evening in order to adhere to the town's charge and to uphold this bylaw. The purpose of the bylaw is to provide the RHC with a tool to assist the commission in its efforts to preserve the town's heritage and to protect historically significant structures with the town, which reflect or constitute distinctive features of architectural, cultural, economic, political, or social history of the town. The full text of the bylaw is available on the town's website. I have a copy here. To respect the goal of upholding the town's charge, we will be following a set agenda and expect everyone to hear to the following guidelines. Prior to addressing the chair, please state your name and address. Be respectful of the individual who is speaking. Paper and pencils can be provided to you to make notes, so when it's your turn, you can voice your questions and comments. Please speak only once until all others have had an opportunity to speak. If there is time, you may get another opportunity. And now I'd like to introduce the members of the commission. You've already met Virginia Adams, Ron Weston, Jack Williams, and Charlene Reynolds Santos at the end of the table. And we have Chris Latham along with
Joseph Luna, the architect for the new project.
Okay. And now I'd like to give the applicant an opportunity to present their project.
All right, thank you. Chris Latham for Reading CRE Ventures LLC, whose principals Saverio Fulcinetti and Praveen Libak Chaya is behind us, as well as their architect, Joe Luna. For the commission's reference, I mentioned previously that this property went through demolition delay several years ago, as the commission may know. There was an outstanding demolition permit that was actually issued, and that was not utilized. This current owner is basically the same owner that owned it previously, different name to the LLC, just for the board's reference.
Okay.
The applicant seeks a demolition permit relative to 258 Main Street. The existing building is depicted in the existing conditions plan at Exhibit B of the application. So, I don't know if the public has seen that, but. The applicant intends to demolish the existing structure so that the lot of land on it, that the property, that the structure is on, may be merged with the abutting property at 262 Main Street in order to construct a new retail consumer use and office building with a pertinent parking. And that proposed plan is also depicted in the application, and that is depicted as Exhibit F. Now, several, as I stated in the application, there are several factors that have led to the applicant's plan. And this has been several years in the planning process and consideration. The first off is the poor existing condition of the existing structure, which Mr. Luna can discuss because he visited this afternoon. The second is the high cost associated with the repair and remodeling to bring the property, the current structure, up to the current codes. So that's a second consideration. The third is the inefficient location, layout, and height of the existing building on the land. And fourth is basically the economic and financial infeasibility of using the existing structure for the quality retail consumer and service and office space rental compared to that could be provided by a new structure. And in conjunction with that is the appurtenances that the zoning bylaws require for such a structure. As I noted in the application, the applicant is willing to offer the structure to the commission, to the town. Obviously, the applicant needs the land, but they are willing to offer the structure and any elements of the structure that the commission would like. Obviously, the applicant is working on a budget, so they need to, obviously, whatever we offer, we need you folks to exercise and wrap up within the next 6 months or so, and obviously at your own cost in dealing with the permitting process or whatever municipal requirements there would be. At this point, I'm going to turn over the presentation to Joe Luna to discuss the existing condition of the property and the structure. And before I do, however, we request that the commission determine that the information that we provided in the application and likewise that we're going to provide tonight is, we request to be determined to be sufficient for what the board needs. And we also request that the board declare tonight that the structure is not protected, or conversely, if the board deems that the property is protected, we request that they make that determination tonight and we can start discussing potential alternatives or suggestions. Thank you. Joe.
Okay, once again, my name is Joseph Luna, L-U-N-A. I'm the principal of Luna Design Group Architects. We are located at 100 Conifer Hill Drive in Danvers. We are the architect for the new building and assisted in the site planning of the project as well. Today I took a drive out to the property to get a more in-depth look at it. We've been focusing as the architect for the new building and haven't been spending a lot of time studying what we're going to do for the old building. But to prepare for this hearing, I took a good walkthrough and got a new jacket because the other one was full of cobwebs when I got back to my office. I don't know the history of the building. I'd be quite candid about that. But I can talk with respect to the condition of the building. I did walk through all floors from the basement up to the second floor in all areas of the building. There is a historical colonial structure that is along the front facade toward Main Street. You can see that it's obviously in figure one in a stone wall. The area is severely overgrown, and if you look closely on figure one up at the roof line, the eave is deteriorating. The whole saw a series of just openings coming up along that and a lot of rot. If you look at the other facades on that, there was a series of additions that were added, and the condition on the front actually is probably the better of it, because the building gets progressively worse as you move around the sides of the building.
As it gets newer.
Yeah, it's falling apart.
Mm-hmm.
I think one thing that's very evident in figure three is just the amount of rot at the corner board. It's a sponge at that point, and the building of that part would have to be completely rebuilt, because the structure has just basically deteriorated from decay. I don't know the last time it was occupied, but it's clear that it has not been stabilized and it's just basically falling apart over time. On the interior, I didn't really know what to expect inside this, but I thought there actually would be more historical elements still left. Anything that in terms of crown moldings and balusters and all that baseboard has basically been stripped through. The building was used as some type of offices, and if you actually go into the plan right now, it's somewhat of a rabbit warren just walking around that interior. And you can see just the condition of what we're looking at in figures five through eight. A particular concern is in figure seven. You can also get a closer view in figure 12, is the building is now open to the weather on that back addition portion. You can clearly see daylight coming through that. And I don't know how long it's been in condition, but with another winter coming on, I can only imagine that the structure is going to continue to deteriorate. I know that there are the beehive ovens inside here. I didn't know where they were, and I didn't see them. No, to be quite honest. I thought they would be downstairs in the basement, and I went wandering down in the basement looking. Yeah, so I understand they're on the first floor. I don't believe I got an accurate photograph of that. In discussions with the owners on this and what we are planning on doing for the new structure, that element of the beehive oven we could technically remove and work it into some type of piece inside the new structure as a focal point as you come into the lobby. I would need to get more accurate information in terms of how we can dismantle it and reassemble it. But there is a spot inside the building, the new building, that we could actually offer that as a focal point element inside that. As far as saving or even trying to move the building, I don't know if it could survive it, given the condition that it is right now. At least the front portion would have the most legitimate chance of being moved, but the back structures are so deteriorated at this point that they're just basically just hanging on by lap boards and whatever else is holding the thing together. I think once you actually try to remove it, it probably would collapse on itself just because of the amount of rot that you can see. And again, on the interior, if there were more elements that were worth saving, but it really looks like when they did the office renovation to this, at some point they stripped all the detail out of that, and it's just basically just the original trim that's around the windows, but all the baseboard and any type of architectural details have long been since removed. As far as the building being able to be reused, this is not conducive to use as an office building now. The walls, and just to bring the building up to code, we do so much work on this thing that we would have to bring it up to current seismic codes, current energy codes. The floor-to-floor heights are relatively low and not conducive to actually putting in a workable office space of a working environment that would be leasable. So although we don't like to be on the side of tearing down buildings, aside from the front portion of it, I don't know if there's really much except for those ovens that can be salvaged out of this existing structure, just given the current condition of it right now. You can also see on figure four, the wraparound porch is rotting. It was just really surprising to me how bad the condition of the building had gotten to at this point. So the Christmas trees in the parking lot are a lot healthier than this building right now.
It's not that
old. Not as old.
Not as old, no. Not as old.
Thank you. I would like to have Jack Williams read the overview of the historical and architectural significance of the building.
Good
Can I add lib a few things as I go along?
Sure.
I just did.
The house on this commercial lot is a typical federal-style New England house. With five windows across the front and a center entrance doorway with a split pediment and a funerary urn in the split. Paired brackets on the roof eaves.
Yep.
And eave returns are updates added to the federal-style structure. These are Italianate, and I suspect at the same time that the brackets were added, the under soffit was extended out, which is not atypical of an Italianate. However, the house is far from typical. The building consists of one room deep main antique block with extensions to the rear. One extension on the southern side was probably part of the original house, while others were modern day replacements of additions that served as connectors to a barn. Currently, the additions have been sectioned to accommodate the last tenant's use as a bridal saloon. Salon.
And that'd be more fun.
Especially for the brides.
The antique main block, which is merely one room deep, holds two outstanding and rare beehive bake ovens in the first floor fireplaces. These ovens help date the house to the late 1700s or early 1800s. Historical significance. Named for an early owner, the Goodwin House's origins are unclear. Previous historians conjecture that the house may have been moved to the Main Street location at least by 1820. The puzzle rests in the fireplace construction and the beehive ovens built in the pre-Revolutionary War style, yet no house is shown here on the 1765 and 1795 maps. In fact, Main Street was constructed and opened in 1806 as the Andover-Medford Turnpike, and this house faces east in the street. John Goodwin purchased the land and was a shoemaker, as were many other young men in Reading. He was not prosperous and died at a fairly young age in 1843. His second wife was compelled to sell the house to settle his debts. Subsequent shoemakers owned the property, employing a few hands that worked and lived in the old L connecting to a barn. By 1880, the chain of shoemakers ended and the place became chiefly residential for the next 90 years. The old L to the rear was torn down and rebuilt in 1940. Other modifications have erased some of the antiquity. However, the house still maintains its historic character and prominence along Main Street.
Thank you. Now I'd like to open it up to public comment. If I could just remind everyone to state your name and address before you speak, and everyone will have an opportunity to speak.
Michelle Kramer, 19 Knollwood Road. We live on Southern Main Street, and we're very excited about the possibility of improving Main Street's look. We have a fire to one house across the street, which I know has nothing to do with you folks. We're finally getting some niceness to our end of the street. The prominence of this house, unfortunately, with the lack of upkeep over the years, does not bring any prominence to the end of our street. It brings just ugliness. It's dangerous for people that are walking by. We're waiting for any day when that wall is gonna collapse as somebody is walking down the street with their child next to them on a bicycle. The property inside, the property itself, the beehive ovens, that's phenomenal that they exist, and it would be awesome if they could be saved somewhere. But yeah, the building is definitely, you know, it was 2.5 years ago when the then building inspector in the Reading came down and told the band families not to let their children go near the building while selling trees because he felt that, and I know he's gone, so I can't, you can only believe me. He said, don't let them go near it. I'm afraid that if they go up on the porch or anything like that, that somebody could be injured. So they've been nice enough to sell the band, but it's, I think, I'm all for the beehive and saving them, but it's time to let the property become a property that we admire on south end of Reading. You know, and I know next week is when we can talk about what that property property might look like and conservation and all that, but this house has seen its time. We have other beautiful homes in Reading that have been maintained for our culture and our significance, but this one, the time has passed. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, if there are no one else wants to address the commission, does anyone have any questions of the applicants on the commission?
Yeah. Well, we've seen the topographical layout. It essentially converts the historic building with all of its appurtenant structures and L's to a box. What is the structure actually going to look like? Side and front views. Will it be attractive? Will it maintain the character of the neighborhood somewhat and sort of preserve some sort of historic element?
Well, I wish I could tell you that's what the concept would be, but it's a much more contemporary style building going up as a gateway building into the city for the new structure. So if the building is essentially a square with the primary entry at the back end of the building, and elevators and stair cores and bathroom cores all at the back of the building, toward the front facing the street. It will be a glass and panel building. This is the initial concept design right now.
Very modern.
Yes, it is.
Strikingly modern with not even brick. It's large blocks and lots of glass.
It'll be cement fiberboard panels. We can have the panels are custom colored, and then the side where you see the darker material is a simulated wood siding. It's not vinyl, but it's cement fiberboard. Oftentimes you hear the term hardy panel, but it'll have the look of a simulated wood on that. We can't build a building using traditional wood materials like that just because of current codes. I can't have the combustible materials on this. I'm limited because of the size of the building in terms of what I can clad materials with. So
there's essentially, you can barely find the entry on
entry,
the front.
Right, the entry will not be on the front.
Yeah,
the entry is on the back. The orientation in terms of how you come into the building.
Looks like a safety door then, huh?
What was that?
The front, it says front corner right. Is that a door right there?
It potentially a door, but it would be a tenant door. If you look at the back of the building, which is
okay.
The facade there, that's the primary entrance into the building. And then there'll be retail entries on the side. If you look at the site plan, we have parking lots on each side that will be able to serve retail entries from each side.
Okay.
Has the square footage decreased from the presentation you made a couple of weeks ago to the CDC? Because you've gotten rid of a parking space on the site plan.
We actually had more parking in that original plan
But did you have to reduce the square footage of the building?
No, we were able just to squeeze it in. We're right at limits. There was an extra parking space that was shoehorned in before.
This one right to the left of the building.
Would it be appropriate to share this with the...
Sure.
Virginia, where is...
I would have made additional copies, but
that
was for next week.
Where are the Beehive Ovens? Is it just the first floor?
Yes, just in the first floor. It's very unusual to have two bake ovens in the structure, and we kind of conjectured that perhaps a widow was living in one portion of the house and the family, a younger portion of the family.
Were they back-to-back?
No.
Sort of?
That's why there's two chimneys. If you see the large square chimney in the front facade in figure four, that holds the main fireplace, which is large.
Okay.
And has a beehive oven in there. But then the other one is on the...
Is it on figure three, that smaller one?
No.
No?
Yes, it is actually, but it's kind of difficult to think of it. And so it's in the northern room.
Okay.
Yeah.
couldn't quite remember.
I think it would certainly be useful for us to go through the building again, but I have a few questions. First of all, we don't have any letter stating from the owners that Chris is representing them, but I guess because they're sitting in your back, we're going to accept that, right?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Because we do have to deal with the owner and its their representatives. How long have the present owners been in ownership of the structure? You said they changed their LLCs, but
right.
How long have they been?
I'm trying to remember when it used to be owned by Carter and Coleman.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if exactly how Carter and Coleman held it, but it probably, what do you think? Like
in total, probably about 4 years.
4 years. There were problems, as you may be aware of, with the financial markets and their lending to real estate entities, and unfortunately, Severio experienced that. And so that had a significant impact on this project. As I said previously, there was a demolition delay that had been applied for.
Just as a reminder, too, we actually went through a 1 year demo delay last time around.
That's right.
So
yeah.
The first year was spent in delay.
Right.
And then this time we added the second lot, so we're combining the two lots into making
mm-hmm.
it.
Right. They're,
yeah,
they're under contract.
That was basically a suggestion with the previous DRT name that we did a couple years back. So.
Yeah, we had gone through an informal CPDC process several years back, and one of the recommendations that the town had made is to purchase an abutting property or to try to get into a contract with an abutting property to have common parking. So they approached the two commercial abutters. One of them wasn't even interested. On the other abutter at 262 was interested, and we are in contract right now relative to that particular lot.
If I could continue. Yeah. Well, having owned it for 4 years, that building has experienced great deterioration under their ownership. And I don't want to hear that it should be torn down because of the poor condition, because that was the purview of the owners to take care of their property. I mean, there's been large boulder out in the sidewalk for quite some time, and no one has taken care of that. I think it's a great public service that they allow the band to sell their Christmas trees there, but I'm just taken aback at the poor condition that is the responsibility from the owner's poor judgment of keeping it up. I guess I'd just further say that it is our job to try to preserve the listed structure. Now, it may not be possible to preserve it, and I think we appreciate your offer to allow it to be moved, which is probably unlikely because you've told us how terrible condition it was.
The other is just to get it off of that. It sits high, and how you're
right.
going to actually physically get it up, jack it, and move it.
Yeah, you could from the back.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of work to do that.
If it's that early a house, it should be posted being construction so that they do kind of move easily.
Once you peel it back and find out what the construction is.
Yeah.
With all the plaster and wallboard and stuff is obscuring the...
I'll tell you,
the
I used to have an old house like this,
yeah.
and we demoed it down to the bare studs. And
yeah.
when you took off all that horsehair plaster and lath boards, the house was just swaying because it's basically acting as a diaphragm that's
right.
holding everything together. So I don't think you want to touch it too much at this point right now, just to peel it back, because it'll make the house more unstable at this point.
Yeah.
Because they didn't have plywood that was basically holding it all together. They have braces, but what, even though you can't factor it in structurally, all that lap board and material is basically holding it all together from racking, so.
This property, as the commission knows, has been vacant for quite a while, that precedes my client. And I think one of the reasons why it's been vacant is because it's, and I love history and I love historic buildings, but it's, the building as it is right now is not financially and economically feasible for what current tenants look for in the market. And that's a large part of the problem.
In the last round, we had suggested just preserving the main block of the house and letting all the additions be taken off. So that was one of our suggestions last time.
It's a very well proportioned federal style house. And if you were to concern yourself only with the front block, it could be moved. I don't think there's any question about that. You put a grillage under it, lift it up, and some cross braces and drive it down the street. The only impediment to moving a house like this are usually the utility lines in the way.
And finding another lot.
Finding another lot.
Getting ready.
Right? But you could, if one wanted to, move this rather expeditiously. I mean, the sad thing is that we are in the town of Reading, our past as well as our present. And the past doesn't go away in one big cataclysmic effort. It goes away in little nibbles and bites. A house here, a house there, and all of a sudden, you no longer have the community that we all wanted and loved. And so we, as a commission, have to try to find every way possible, either through moving or preservation or whatever, on every single structure and every single building. Even if you make the excuse that in fact it is deteriorating, we're all deteriorating. And yet we all still try to preserve ourselves. And so I think that
and we all have time to go too.
But I think it's a shame that a house of this proportion and detail is just casually thrown away without an effort to try to preserve it, either here or on another site. So that's our job, is to try and fight, hammer, spit, claw, kick, to keep it as much as we can.
At Parker Tavern, there's a vacant lot next door to it, isn't there?
I believe so. But I think they have plans for an exhibit area there. I don't know.
I'm startled that the historic structure, the facade that you see on Main Street, is going to be replaced with probably the most modern building I've ever seen, even proposed for the town. And this is a town, it's not a city. You know, I grew up in Lynn. It would never come out the way you meant, but. and that's, you know, there's all kinds of stuff going on in that town with these, you know, brilliant modern facades showing up. And I'm uncomfortable replacing this 1800s building, maybe even earlier than that, with a building that has that appearance, as opposed to preserving some component of that streetscape of visibility in the new design. I was shocked with what I saw compared to attempts throughout the community to preserve the look, preserve the neighborhoods, maintain some compatibility, and I don't think the proposal does it.
Okay.
Now, safety's got to be improved. If it's an unsafe structure, that's got to be dealt with. That's a very serious issue. So we need to move forward, but in the process of moving forward, I would hope that there'd be some way you could respect the past and preserve some sort of a colonial look, not exactly like what was there, but in keeping with that and the adjacent homes. Okay.
A lot of the building materials along Main Street, brick and, well, you know, we're discussing potential and everything. Maybe we need to put it under a demolition delay so that we can negotiate with the owners and get our act together to know what direction we'd like to see. And then we could do an early release if we came up with a solution at this point.
I don't believe the owners just want to just casually tear it down. The problem is...
Do you mind if I say something?
Go ahead.
So my name is Severa Folsom. I've owned the land now since purchasing from Carter and Coleman. I will say that the property was in deplorable condition when I bought it. Immediately, I was told to secure the building by the building department. It was a safety risk from the minute I bought it. You know, obviously, I would have preferred for this to happen a long time ago, and you know, we kind of missed the window with what's happened. I know I don't take for granted what the, you know, the role of what you are all entrusted with. It may seem that I'm some developer coming in to just, you know, knock this thing down and move on. My family actually lived in Reading for about 17 years, so I do know the community. I am very familiar with the community. I have friends here. I am friends with business owners here. I do business in this town. This is not, you know, this is not me just sweeping this thing under the rug and saying, okay, we need to get rid of this thing and let's just move on and make some money. It's a lot more significant than that to me personally.
So then is there a possibility to be able to work with the commission to find some mutually agreeable
Yeah,
zone?
I mean, I think that's the goal ultimately. I think that's why we're all here. You know, we're not here just to say, hey, let's keep moving forward. I you know, Praveen and I would love to find a way to somehow, you know, if not necessarily preserve the structure, but at least preserve the ideology of it, you know, the symbolism, you know, to some extent. So if there's some way to do that, we'd love to do that. You know, we've asked Joe to come up with some creative ideas to somehow preserve that oven, you know, and make it part of the structure. In terms of your concerns about the design of the structure, the dilemma we have is that between all of the guidelines that the town has, bylaws, South Main Street, design initiatives, and everything else, we've tried to meet so many requirements, but this is a near impossible lot. You know, most people would not have attempted to redevelop this lot, and this thing would still be sitting here for another 10 years looking like this. The reality is, it's a very, very restrictive lot, you know, and us purchasing the lot next door has helped hopefully make it a little bit of a nicer project. We'd like to create more green space, and obviously that's not reflected in this. You know, there's a few other things that we'd like to do. Ultimately, we're in a place where we're challenged to basically put up a box and then make that box look, you know, nice and give it some kind of curb appeal. I know that personally my office will be in this building, so for me it's very important. I've got to look at it every day too. You know, it definitely does not fall on deaf ears when you say that, you know, it doesn't quite reflect, you know, what's previously there. It's going to be near impossible to reflect what's there now. There's no way, you know, in the exterior presence of that building to do
within
that.
Within reason.
Well, I'd like to say a word in defense of modern architecture, but also put this into a larger context. This part of Main Street is a strip, essentially, and it has many different kinds of things happening. So when we talk about the context, we're not talking about just the context of this drawing. I would ask you to ask your architect to do a longer drawing that shows the conditions along this strip. Some buildings are set back, some buildings are set forward, there are some historic buildings, so that your architect can come up with a rationale for both the position of your building and its kind of modern architecture. And it may very well be that you're a giant amongst pygmies on this street, which would be wonderful. But I think that that's the way to answer this question, this concern that we have and that everybody in the town's going to have. And so make a long drawing show all the different kinds of conditions, setbacks, parking lots, non-setbacks, the kind of...
No, it's a hodgepodge.
Yeah, but yeah. you need to make a decision as an architect as to what out of that hodgepodge is important and what isn't. And therefore, what you are going to do to either distinguish yourself from the hodgepodge, or what you're going to do to try to make that more coherent.
But I think you
as
could distinguish the
space.
Hodgepodge on this by making a contemporary statement that is well executed.
I'm not arguing. I'm advocating for modern architecture. I'm actually on your side. I'm advocating for good modern architecture.
Because a lot of the modern buildings, the brick facades
yes.
that are all on Main Street are deplorable.
Exactly.
They're not.
So what you need to do, you need to show us through a series of drawings
that we're the smart kid on the block.
That you're contributing to the upgrade of the urban space of this commercial strip of Main Street.
So I
would recommend you go back.
iPhone panoramic
you go back and read Robert Venturi's book on Las Vegas. But that's a really tough project.
Set the stage for appropriate blending.
Right. Well, I think.
But there has to be some rationale for what you're doing besides just putting the building here.
Well, in fairness, that the location of the site is also impacted by the fact that we're very close to another street and we have residential density right behind us. So we sought to basically balance, you know, when you shift the building to the left or you shift the building to the right or you shift it to the back, you're affecting someone else.
Mm-hmm.
That centralized location allows us to avoid impacting those.
Well, you brought it to the forward. You've essentially turned the sock inside out here.
We did.
And so the entrance is in the back, right?
The retail entrances are in the front.
But
the upper level entrances are in the back. Lobby is
but
in
all of these are choices. All of these are choices. For example, you could put the building all the way across and go through it to the back. There are many different ways you could turn the sock.
One of the things, just from an urban standpoint, is not to have a sea of parking in the front of the building.
Right.
That's also consistent with the town's South
yes.
Main Street
so
design.
So pushing the structure forward toward the street, where it could be appreciated from the street, and pushing the parking to the back and to the side with the entries on this was part of the overall master plan in terms of site design. Very easy to push a building to the back and have a sea of parking. We wanted to bring the building forward toward the street so pedestrians can come up onto the platform or walk around the building to get to the primary entrance in the back. The taller elements on the facade are actually toward the back of the building. There's a fourth floor that steps back at the roof line, you can see in the perspectives there, to minimize the scale along the street. So we're doing a lot of the things in terms of a more traditional structure, we're just doing it in a more contemporary, modern interpretation.
But your building is lifted up.
Just by the natural topography.
But the first floor of your elevation is
floating around there.
Yeah, it's glass.
It's a street.
Yeah, the glass is at street level, and the building is a mass
right.
above.
It is a plinth.
And is that
right? It is
that,
a plinth.
Is that characteristic of other buildings on the street, or did you just come up with that?
Buildings have shafts and caps.
Yes.
This building has a base, a shaft, and a cap.
And
the base in this case is supported by columns and glass.
Mm-hmm.
There is a shaft, which is the main structure of the building, that has deep openings inside. So there are historical references on that. And then the cap is lighter than the fact
but
that
are these
step-
but this is a historical reference to what?
This
is
basic.
Is
this
it,
is basic.
It should be a reference to what else is on the street. In other words, if you say that there are no buildings on the street that have this kind of tripart division in its elevation, well, then show us. If there are other buildings that you can create a dialogue with, then show us. But what you need to do is to explain to us the contextual cues that you've taken as an architect in the design of your building. Because right now, all we have is this. And if you were my architectural student, I would say, for shame, please show us the total site.
Well, that extends from 128
well,
to
yeah,
to
but
square.
But I mean, it's easy enough to get from the town, right?
Yeah, it's Google Earth.
But I mean, that's what. If we're going to make a decision, we need to have that kind of information. as you would if you were going to make that, this kind of decision. Is that unreasonable?
This is what you see driving up the highway.
I guess I'm a little curious as to the direction we're headed, because my understanding is we're trying to figure out what to do with the structure that's there, but it seems like we're kind of headed on a track of talking about what's going to be there. What I'd like to focus on is, frankly, what we're going to do with the structure that's there. Because obviously there's a separate set of hearings that we can deal with for where we're going with the site and the structure. I'd like to figure out how we deal with what's there now.
As Virginia suggested, it might be to impose a demolition delay. Continue a dialogue with you and the architect. Follow along with what Jack had suggested. And the alternative is, of course, the 6 months is respected. Another alternative is the delay is released early.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Once we're happy with the conversation and
sure.
and the blending.
Yeah. So what is it at this point that you know all of you feel we could do, or what is it that we could do to figure out a next step? I mean, at this point, I mean, I'm not sure that we've got much direction here. So I guess I'm just trying to understand what
Jack,
I can do.
Jack has essentially suggested that you go away and come back with.
I didn't say that.
Ron has essentially suggested that you listen to the conversation between these two primarily. And work hard on some blending proposals, you know. Show us what is possible along that strip of Route 28.
When you say blending the old structure with the new?
No.
Well, let me put it this way.
You might think about that as a possibility, but
you've got a nondescript commercial strip, Main Street, and you're putting a new building in it. How do you decide what that new building is going to look like? Is it just a lunar lander that comes down at this spot with no regard to its context? Or do you make some sort of decision about the context itself? Maybe it's got some things that are reasonable, and maybe it has nothing that's reasonable. Maybe it's just an ugly strip. But how do you decide what your building is going to look like within that context? That's number one. Number two is, how do you show it? And I'm suggesting a couple of things. One is a drawing that shows a larger context, maybe some buildings in this direction, those in this direction, and this side of the street, including the houses. And then an elevation that shows your building in reference, and I think you'll start to see that there are a lot of open spaces on this strip that are just difficult to deal with. And then how does your architecture contribute something to the future? Because history is not only the past, right? History is as well the future. And then you can answer the questions that my colleagues are asking as well. What's the context here? I mean, it doesn't exist just in isolation. This is not the town of Reading. This is just a building site. With a parking lot around the building. How can we react to that? Does that make sense? Is that clear?
To some extent.
Ask your questions.
As the architect, it's clear.
Yes, I know it is, but.
But I got to convince my client.
No, I get it. It's an exercise for us to deal with outside of this meeting, I suppose.
Yeah.
Can I say something?
Yes.
My name is Linda McKenzie. I'm from Pineville Avenue, 7 Pineville. So I very much will be affected by this. The building will back up to our street. Our street is colonial homes.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, the building where you're talking about, the parking lot that is so wonderful that it's not on Main Street, it will be against my neighbor's backyard.
Mm-hmm.
So not only is the parking lot going to be there, and it's going to take away a residential home that's going to get torn down so that we can build this, I'm sorry, it looks like a parking garage to me, this huge building. But the other piece is it's going to be so high that it's going to be above our buildings. And if you did look at Main Street, you'd see that Fantasia building is just a few houses down, so that there's another overpowering large building that I have lived in front of for 35 years. and if I had to choose again, I may not choose to go there. Now, my neighbor just moved in a couple of months ago and is going in that same direction. I think, what's happening? We're talking about a strip, but we're talking about my neighborhood. We're talking about a family neighborhood with colonial homes in it that's directly going to be affected. Lights at night, I don't know, parking lot, stores. I'm very disturbed by it. And I see a picture. You should show us the picture before you ask us to speak, because I didn't know it was going to look that.
So you would like to amend my comments to add into this drawing, the site plan, the neighborhood in behind. So we could see the context behind. And I apologize for just talking about the front, and I should have been talking about the back as well, because that's also.
So just to give you a little bit of feedback, right now the lot, the physical concrete actually goes right to the lot line. What will happen in the future is that parking lot actually gets decreased because of the buffers for conservation and because of the way that the lot is zoned. So you actually won't see as much concrete, you'll actually see less. And so the parking lot will not abut right back to that fence line. In terms of the height, we've actually measured the height of the existing building, and our building is actually the same exact height. It's not taller.
It says it's four. It looks like four stories with an
right,
another
but it
appendage
sits up on a
there.
It sits up on a crest, so that's what makes it much taller than it is. We will be bringing the land down.
But
we could bring it down to street level,
street level
as opposed to 6 feet.
It'll just be more massive. It might be the same height, but there'll be more structure at that higher level.
Just by the nature of the type of building, it's going to be massive. It's not a house. It's a retail office building.
Which is zoned for.
Right.
And as an alternative, you should know that what I did avoid doing, rather than the alternative here for us prior to coming before you, was that we were approached by a Dunkin' Donuts franchisee. So the alternative for this lot at the time was for this to become a drive-through Dunkin' Donuts,
that's not worse
at the time. That was the alternative project proposed, and that's what started to get permitted.
Right.
Yeah.
And then you could have
another
cartoon version of colonial architecture with, you know,
but
an overstuffed CVS or a Dunkin' Donuts trying to look like it's a house.
What we also have to remember is this property has not been a house for a very long time. I remember going in here to Tiger's Den and getting my hair cut as a kid. I remember you showing me the Beehive Alley.
Could we answer the neighbor's concerns by asking you to have your architect draw this context in behind so that you may see where your house is in relationship to this particular project, and then you could have a lot of your questions both clarified, if not answered. But it would also give you some security that in fact what's happening.
These are aerial renderings to show that much.
Well, yeah, but
context.
I mean, you know.
Excuse me, Charlene.
Yeah, it seems obvious that we are. There's a lot of concern from everybody about what this new structure might appear like. But what do we need to do to complete this hearing right now? I mean, to complete the hearing and make a decision, we don't need to know just what this structure is going to look like.
Right.
I think, do we, maybe it's time for us to decide if we have enough information to make a decision as to whether we can choose to hold it or not. And then, you know, we can decide on these other things. We're not going to get any further on what it looks like this evening.
Right.
And when we make our decision, then they'll have information and they can go off and work on that next step.
Okay.
Yeah, I think I have enough information to make that decision.
I feel like that.
I'd like to just let the public have one
yep.
more.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. I saw a hand raised.
Thank you. Steve Cook, I live on Old Road. That property, you know, butts pretty much to the back. Right along the wetlands that's shown on one of those maps there. You know, we've been in our house for 21 years, 22, 23 years. When we moved in, that was a retail location. We knew it was a retail location. Nothing has changed in the 23 years. Unfortunately, nothing has changed. You know, the boulder falling down, which I believe is actually falls because part of the sidewalk is actually the jurisdiction of the state. state, I believe, because they've got their buffer from the street. Secondly, you know, the parking lot hasn't gone down, you know, it's been vacant, so there aren't spotlights in the parking lot and so forth. You know, the safety of the building, to speak of that, you know, I mean, the cost to bring it up to code to rebuild it or to keep it safe so people can walk through there must be astronomical at this point. And then traveling up and down Main Street, you know, I mean, it's a hodgepodge, as you say, of architectural delights. but when you get to the corner of Knollwood and start heading up closer to downtown Reading, you've got that building on the left, but because it's so elevated and everyone's going 40 miles an hour with two lanes of traffic each way, you know, you'd cause a traffic accident to stop and marvel at the architecture of the building. You know, and there's, you know, and then across the street is a burned out house that's been burned out for about 8 years now. Nothing's been, you know, it's sitting there vacant, you know. I'm all for moving forward. You know, there's already been a delay on this thing, you know, to tear it down. Let's move forward, you know. And, you know, America's been built on progress. You know, let's move forward, you know. And there's plenty of places in town that have been preserved and have opportunities to preserve more. I think at Main Street, you know, no one's going to be slowing down to marvel at, you know, at this old house that, you know, has fallen apart a long, long time ago.
I think we'd like to move forward also, just to do it under the best context, respecting the neighbors' needs and preferences, and also the character of the town. So.
Plenty of character. Seriously?
Yep.
My name's Mary Richards. I live at 50 Pineville Ave. I agree with quite a bit of what my neighbor just said. I also am a historian, and I appreciate the efforts of this committee, and I think that with more creativity there could be a way to save some elements, whether it's dismantling it or if you demo the new parts and you know, investigate that box, the original part of the house, see if it is post and beam, maybe it can be disassembled and later re-erected somewhere in town. I realize these things take a tremendous amount of time. Strawberry Bank in Portsmouth is an example of saved houses that were going to be torn down in other parts, and it was a huge undertaking. And what would we do if we didn't have them? But I think there are safety issues, and I appreciate that there are people willing to invest in the property, and, you know, I appreciate the difficulty of the situation.
Okay, thank you. Okay, does anyone have any other questions or concerns?
Did the applicants have any?
Or do the applicants? No? Okay. So then I would like to move that the presented information is sufficient to make a final determination on the request of demolition of the structure at 258 Main Street, and that the public hearing be closed.
Second.
This is a motion that the material is significant.
We have enough information to make a decision.
A decision. It's not the decision itself.
No. That's
okay.
Next.
I will second that.
That's next.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
I can vote.
Yeah. We've done that in a while. Okay. So the hearing's closed. Thanks everyone for attending. Moving right along, I'd like to move that the loss of the structure at 258 Main Street would be detrimental to the town under the purposes of this bylaw 7.2.1, and that a demolition delay of up to 6 months be imposed beginning this date.
I'll second that.
Okay. All in favor?
No.
Okay.
Is that 5-0?
Yep.
Oh, okay.
so we continue working.
Okay.
So
there's more work to do.
So we will continue to, one, work on what we can do with the existing building, and two, what the future's gonna look like.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Should we be contacting you?
Probably easier than send out emails to everybody else. Does the commission, while we're still here, have any ideas of any other properties that potentially this structure could be moved to? I mean, is there any, I mean, Parker was the only one I could think of.
Yeah. That's the problem. We don't have, the town really doesn't have any vacant properties, and we don't have any funds that can support it. So
Parker's so close. I mean, I don't know how much it would cost to take all the lines.
Yeah, and that is, I think that's not town.
No, it's just, it's
private,
right?
Yeah.
It's gonna end up in the ghost of Reading.
It's finding the lot.
Yeah, it's
finding the
Strawberry Bank.
It's the top of the list to research and see what we can do in the shortest amount of time.
All right.
So the hearing is over, we can push the button.